Sequence is of Turkey Shoot, my entrance into the stunt profession. My first day ever in front of cameras flying hang gliders. I'm doubling for Molly, the actress who witnesses the murder, her brother who mistakenly gets killed by the murderers. I'm acting in it. I'm the guy on the side of the cliff talking about Draper Taggart, and I technically directed this following footage of my first ever stunt work on Hawaii 5-0.
Ready?
That's a beauty. Hey, Rob, who's that up there?
Taggart's the name.
Taggart.
Draper Taggart.
Sure knows how to ride that thing.
He's the only one who can. It's a 20-footer.
The following episode of Hawaii 5-0, they asked me if I could land a hang glider on the roof of a building. This was a stunt that had never been done before. So like the first one, crashing a hang glider into the ocean is a little softer landing. This time, trying to land a hang glider on the roof of a building created some serious difficulties.
Normally it'd be impossible because the wind comes from this direction, creating a downdraft on top of the roof. So we were going to do it a combination of ways with hanging the glider from underneath the helicopter, and then also showing that point of view with me coming in with the helicopter, and then just building a scaffolding up on top of the roof where I could just run off the scaffolding and then land. So the distant shot, we would see just the glider coming in and landing on the roof of the building. But we got real lucky that day. So we built the scaffolding just above the fence so that we could give them the shot of the hang glider coming down, clearing the fence, and actually landing on the roof of that building. We pulled it off in one take. Next episode up is another Hawaii 5-0 entitled Heads, You're Dead. They flipped a coin and it came up heads, so they threw us a leaky life raft after kidnapping us and stealing our big yacht, and they threw us overboard and took our boat, left us out in the middle of the Pacific to die. But it was McGarrett to the rescue, and all went well once again. Book 'em, Dano, on Hawaii 5-0.
Expect us to take you all the way to Hong Kong, did you? We wouldn't last 30 minutes in these waters without a life raft.
Oh, yeah? Try it! Hey, Charlie, I got an idea.
Yeah?
We're slipping for it. Tails to get the life raft. Heads are dead.
All right. That sounds fair enough to me. But as I always said, first things first. And now the first thing I want you all to do is get up. Come on.
All right, you're first. You're first.
Get up there. Get up there. Get up there. Get up there!
I should have known.
What?
Going back like that. They punched a hole in it.
Oh.
No, they punched two.
They've got to be sick.
Hey, starting to leak pretty bad up here. How much of that tape we got left?
That's it, Skipper.
You know, things don't look too good right now, Miss Wells. But if you stop to think about it...
It gets worse. He hasn't seen that movie.
Look!
Hey!
There's a plane up there!
Yeah, here. Hey! Over here!
Over there, Mike. What is it? I'm not sure. Sometimes the sun hitting the water just right makes it clear like that.
Next up, television series that went for years called Sanford and Son. They did a special episode filmed in Hawaii. I play the surfing instructor, although most of my footage ended up on the cutting room floor. Here's Red Fox playing the part of the pigeon and DeMont Wilson and I on the beach in Waikiki.
This is a palm tree and this is a coconut. Fred and Lamont got here because of these three crooks.
Now that you stole all of these diamonds, can we go home now?
Right. Hey, did you check the airport?
Yep. Got cops all over the place. We'll never get past them.
What about the cruise ships?
It's the same thing. Look, with our record, they're going to search us from head to toe.
But this means we're going to have to find some real clean pigeon to get them diamonds back into California for us, huh?
This is a pigeon. And the crooks hid the diamonds in his suitcase.
The next sequence was filmed in 1978, and it was HBO's first attempt at a sports show. They originally entitled it Death Defiers, which would feature the fastest skiers in the world from Storm Peak, Steve McKinney, who hit speeds of over 120 miles an hour, Carl Banish, base jumping from 600 feet, and then the first acrobatic formation hang gliding team in the world that I put together in Hawaii, flying the cliffs of Makapu. The title Death Defiers didn't hold for long. Unfortunately, one of my best guys, Steve Rayfield, who designed the majority of our high-performance gliders back in 1978, was one of the first in the world to do a complete loop in a hang glider. On a day off of filming, Steve went out to show that he could complete a full loop in the hang glider to be featured the next day. Unfortunately, Steve performed several in a row, and then he hit the cliff and was killed instantly. The big tall guy, Duff King, we also lost Duff in a hang gliding accident several years later. So this following sequence from HBO, now entitled Thrill Sports, is dedicated to Duff King and Steve Rayfield, who gave their lives doing what they loved most, flying like the birds.
Hi, I'm Greg Lewis. Standing on the edge of a cliff, peering down into the valley hundreds and hundreds of feet below, or looking down a mountain slope so steep that snow barely clings to it, are experiences terrifying for most of us. For the average person, the thought of falling helplessly through the air, of losing all control, can produce paralyzing fear. It's the stuff of nightmares. But for a certain group of people, this isn't a nightmare at all. This confrontation with fear, in fact, is a thrill, often producing euphoria. We've traveled to three spectacular places to see these death defiers. My partner, Mike Siri, recently went to Oahu in Hawaii, where hang gliders soared on the winds that blow up against the 1,300-foot cliff at Makapu Point. Hang gliders will tell you that theirs is a safe sport, and it may be, unless the wind suddenly changes, and then it's not safe anymore, which many of them have learned with painful consequences.
Basically, falling down the face of the cliff, trying to run down there, I slammed into the boulder about 50 feet down below, dislocated my left shoulder, kicked me into the air, and hung me from my back rear wire. So now I'm hanging out at 1,200 feet in the air, dislocated shoulder, and I'm hanging from a rear wire. I pushed out, and the glider continued to rise, and somehow I got over the top of the cliff, came back around, and landed up on top of the cliff, standing up, going, what? You know, what happened? And there was no reason, no explainable reason that I can feel how I got back up on top. It felt like somebody reached me, you know, picked me up and lifted me back up on top, because I was very low and I bounced into the air and I was hanging. I had no control of the glider other than what my mind was thinking that I wanted it to do.
There's a superstition among hang gliders that after 2 years, they should retire, because at that time they might become arrogant or careless, or their luck might run out.
Since it is very easy to get into, easy to learn, it's also very easy to kill yourself. And if you don't pre-flight and take care of your glider and check everything every day and go through your checklist just like any other pilot does, and you check your craft thoroughly, then knowing that, there's no longer any apprehension when you go to take off. You know your craft is sound.
The paradox is that to have the expertise and concentration to make the ultimate flight, soaring off Makapu Ridge, requires tremendous experience. The men Mike Siri met at Makapu haven't retired after 2 years, and the sensations they have in the air there will no doubt postpone their retirement for a long time.
This is hang gliding like nowhere else in the world. These pilots in Hawaii are on the extreme edge of their sport.
The launching pad atop Makapu Ridge is not the public domain of just any hang glider brave enough to try. It belongs to the Hawaiian Hang Gliding Association, and one must first pass a written test and several test flights off of lesser peaks before they'll let you give it a go. Because for 11 hang gliders, their flight off of Makapu was their very last.
I've been looking for other places that were comparable or comparable to Makapu. I was in Africa, South Africa, and found places that did have high cliffs, but the wind just wasn't consistent. The trade wind flows the most consistent airflow in the world. It blows northeast, 08, 07, 090, 75% to 80% of the time.
And how? What's the velocity?
Velocity is an average of 15 to 20 miles per hour. A velocity.
It's no longer a sled ride down. All of a sudden, when you take off, when you go to step off the edge of the cliff, it's not like you're going to take off and take a dive down. You step off and you blast off. You rise 1,000 feet straight up.
Went out there today or tomorrow, what's the feeling when you stand on that ledge?
Fear
without the glider. I mean, it's a 1300 foot cliff straight down, and
it's an everyday test of your own personal karma. You know, you step into the air, you've lost your body, you only have a mind to react to the wind and to God, and he either makes love to you or he spanks you like a child. And that's, you know, kind of where it's all at.
You're 28, right? Think you'll live to be 33?
I don't think I'll ever die.
John, most of the guys are flying prone. How can you fly seated?
Well, basically for comfort, because of our long flights here, I can stay in the air indefinitely, actually.
But I also used to have problems with my,
when I was flying prone, I have a stereo set that I fly.
Can you listen to music?
Yeah, but we have a very high fidelity stereo system that it fits right across your chest. And I used to, when I was flying prone, I'd go to change tapes, and my tapes would go spiraling down. So after losing about $100 or so in tapes and a couple of pairs of headphones, I switched back.
What's the best music to hang glide to?
You know, any of your good Moody Blues and Alan Parsons. And you can, you know, whatever your mood is, whatever you feel like. You know, it's just, you can get up there in the air and you finally have escaped.
The perfect conditions and the ability of these pilots allows them to soar for hours. The world record for time in the air hang gliding was set here at over 19 hours. But they're always aware that they are over 2,000 feet up.
Like I said before, you can't be afraid because it impedes your judgment. But you shouldn't be flying for other people. You should fly for yourself and just enjoy it for yourself. If you're out there to put on a show all the time, you're going to get into trouble sooner or later. And that's usually when I crash, is doing something like that.
Steve Rayfield died while flying off of Makapu shortly after our filming. This is Mike Siri reporting for HBO Sports from Hawaii.
Ed Caesar and John Thorp and the others who fly at Makapu are members of an elite group. They have taken the sport of hang gliding to levels beyond the imagination of most others. Almost all people who seek out participation in extremely dangerous sports say that at the most critical moment, their body experiences an extreme energy rush, which is why they come back to the cliff or to the mountaintop. Some theorize that this energy flow through the body is actually an adrenaline high, adrenaline surging through their veins, and they say that you can become addicted to it.